Everybody's buzzing with caffeine. You're ready to go. You're here for the 2 o'clock Making the Most of Mobile session. We're going to turn it over to the fabulous panelists any minute, but what we're going to try to do is make it as interactive as possible. So when you have a question, go ahead and raise your hand, and I'll get the mic to you so everybody can hear the question. And I do a good job of bouncing back and forth, so no worries. And if you can't get a hold of me, my name is Danielle. I work with the BlogHer team. So without further ado, I'll turn it over to our fabulous panelists.
Thanks so much, Danielle. Welcome, everybody. My name is Angela Lasasso, and I'm the Director of Social Media for Research in Motion. If you don't know who Research in Motion is, that's okay. Nobody does. They recognize by our brand name, which is BlackBerry. So welcome. That's why I'm here on the mobile panel. I'm here with three very, in my world, they're famous colleagues, I guess. And I'll let them introduce themselves, but I'm really excited to be here with them and to talk with you today. So welcome.
Hi, I'm Amy Friedlander Hoffman. I run a company called Priority Digital Media. It's a strategic consulting group that focuses on content, working with media and technology companies and content across television, broadband, and mobile. Prior to that, I was the Senior VP of Programming for AT&T, helping build their television service, UVerse, and running all the broadband programming.
Hi, I'm Barb Dibwad. I'm director of content at a startup called Tekka. We're a consumer electronics-focused website, and I'm heading up our content arm. And I've come to mobile through primarily the technology journalism space, having covered it for a number of years. But now also at Tekka, I have a lot of input on the product development, where we actually have mobile apps for Android, iPhone, and iPad, and Android tablets as well. So a little bit of the general global space of mobile, but also the practical application of actually getting a mobile experience going, too.
So I'm Nina Bhatti, and I'm a research principal scientist at HP Labs. And I've been working in mobile a long time when it was kind of clunky and yucky, and we used to dream about all the things we could do if the platform would only get there. And, I mean, I was an intern in Xerox PARC in 92 working on an 8-bit microprocessor that used IR for communication called the PARC tab. So in 1992, we were imagining all kinds of context-aware services and things. Now we actually have platforms to make things happen that we were only dreaming and struggling with for the last couple of decades. And I've since done research in a lot of areas, but one area I'm working in right now, which is mobile sensing applications, so that you can actually take advantage of the fact that you have a handset. It's not just a small browser, but it's actually got its own value that's unique because you can take it wherever you go. So I'm really excited about what's happening in mobile, and I think it gives us not just limitations, but actually a huge opportunity.
Yeah, and what I found interesting, we had a quick phone call last week and getting to know each other, those of us on the panel, and I think what a lot of us have in common is actually we've all been entrepreneurs at some point or another, or have had to be entrepreneurial within the corporations that we work. So I was the first full-time social media employee at HP, which is where I know Nina's name from. But prior to that, I actually owned my own company. But prior to that, I helped launch CNET and Netflix. So I also came to it from the tech journalism point of view and worked at some trades along the time. But I think when you look at it from an ecosystem point of view, you have a lot to share with folks who are trying to build their own services and build their own ecosystems and build their own revenue patterns. When it comes overall to mobile, I think some of the things that are happening in the industry right now are very pertinent to what you want to know, especially when it comes to being in technology or building content for people. Increasingly around the world, their PCs are this, whether it be economic or convenience or just preference. And so if you're thinking about building an economic model for your business, for your service, increasingly you have to take mobile into consideration. I'd like to toss it over to you guys and see if you agree.
I mean, I think it's definitely important. It's interesting. In the content world, I think mobile has actually moved slower than a lot of the rest of the world has from an e-commerce and from other perspectives. There was a huge amount of hype around mobile a few years ago and huge deals being done. Sprint did a deal with the NFL for hundreds of millions of dollars. AT&T and HBO did a $100 million deal around the entourage and doing some marketing. And a lot of those things proved to be too early. And now we're finally starting to see some of from the really kind of old world content space start to move into mobile. If you look at video growth in mobile, it's about 43% growth from, you know, 2009 to 2010 in consumption of video, which is pretty big numbers. If you look at that number still comparative to television watching, it's 2% of what people actually watch and consume every month on television. So it's still, you know, I think from people that are looking at the focus of it from a content and entertainment perspective, you're probably right at the right spot to be starting to think about mobile, because we're just getting really the beginning of that stuff taking off from a video watching perspective.
I think it's interesting, too, and I was having this conversation with you last night about how I actually spoke at the first BlogHer in 2005 on a panel about mobile, as in this mobile, hey, it's a big thing. This thing is really happening. It's the hotness. Well, fast forward 6 years later, it's still the hotness. It's still happening. We're getting there. We're getting farther with the platforms. Now, how many people in here have smartphones?
I mean, thank you. I love you.
That it's an astounding figure. You start to look at some of the numbers that are coming out, 300 million total worldwide smartphone sales in 2010, which was a 70% increase over 2009. There was a statistic that just came out of CTIA recently, which is a big mobile wireless conference in the States, that three times as many smartphone activations are occurring per minute as babies being born, which prompted someone, of course, to leave a funny tweet about how we need to be having babies more frequently. But that's sort of the numbers that we're talking about, and the prevalence and the convenience factor of having a device in your pocket that's literally more powerful than the computer you had on your desk or on your lap even 5 years ago is enormous.
I think the other trend that I see that's really broken loose, and some people, I was working at Nokia several years ago when it was still the walled garden estates line of reasoning about mobile, and I think that that one of the biggest trends that's making everything possible is no mobile handset manufacturer or carrier could innovate at the rate of entrepreneurs who want to create apps. It's just not physically possible to have all these people with niche channels. And the one thing I can tell you about mobile apps to me that are really successful is the way I think about it is it's a haiku style of user interface, right? You know, there's poetry and there's haiku poetry, right? You only get a few words. You get very limited, but it almost makes you, like some of the apps I see that are really good, they distill out what is the most important thing that I get from the website that everybody does, and we're going to make that super easy and fast because they can't handle more than 5 button pushes. That actually has certain websites, I think the mobile's better because I don't have all this nonsense on here, because all the stuff I do all the time, like if I do something that's frequent, it's easier, it's better. So I think the opening up of the platform in terms of anybody putting software on there, anybody being able to launch an app, that to me is a transformation that's occurred at the very end of the platform evolution, and that makes it so that more people can innovate, because before, I can tell you, having been at Nokia and working with carriers, it was so hard to justify something that was going to be shipped on a handset, who was going to use it, to put something on board. It had to be very horizontal. What I think is really great in the haiku style of user interface is it can just do one thing super well, and you're willing to download it and just use that one feature, which is so much better than trying to do everything with one kind of user interface.
Yeah, I think it's a good point. I was looking up some stats and getting some stats and stuff. Average number of apps on a mobile user's device is 13.5, with 3.2 being paid apps. That's the latest stats I have. I don't know if you guys have anything that's sooner, since the panel before has talked about making sure that your research is up to date. So, 52% increase in downloaded game apps in 2010, making them the largest app category. Does that surprise anybody? Angry Birds? Okay. 17% decrease, though, in paid apps in 2010. So that really speaks to the value of a couple things. The opportunity, I think, to broaden your ecosystem and be acceptant of advertising and marketing in your apps to have a revenue stream. But I also think you have to look at it at a broader ecosystem even beyond just the device. You know, what's your platform? What is your larger syndication and distribution system? And you have a lot of experience with syndication and distribution.
Yeah, I mean, it's the whole, you know, content world's a little bit upside down right now and will continue to be, right? I mean, it's you've got a lot of factors, and whether it's on internet or mobile, the traditional way that content has been made and paid for has been broadcast model with advertising plus subscription model with carriers, with, you know, the Comcast and the DirecTVs and the dishes of the world. So, you know, now you're moving into a situation, particularly for content, where it's been the ability to pirate that content. So you can either offer it up and offer it up at a reasonable price, or people will just steal it. So you have people in, you know, a lot of content people now in the middle of that, and particularly how it relates to online and mobile. Do I offer that content? Do I offer it for free? Can it actually work in an ad-supported way, which is generally no. There's a big movement called TV Everywhere that is about somebody has a subscription to a television service, and that will then allow them to watch that on broadband and on mobile, where people want to consume that content. So it's a tricky place, and it will continue to get probably a lot messier before it gets cleaner for content production and how you take that from the traditional television place and move it onto other platforms like mobile.
Second most popular category, not also probably not surprising, social networking and retail. So about the same there. And I know you've seen a lot of apps and app development and models come in your time coverage of this industry. Do you want to talk a little bit about that?
Absolutely. I think mobile as a device is by nature a social device. I mean, before we were able to run applications on top of it, it was a device, and some people don't even remember anymore, that you used to pick up and actually speak to people verbally on
Crazy.
The phone.
Crazy.
That trend is absolutely going away, but that was the original sort of use case for the phone. So now that we have an ability to layer on software on top of that, you can do a lot more. There's still this historical and sort of practical trend towards thinking about this device in a very intimate way as a device that's fundamentally built for communication, whether it's now, you know, you're using it to tweet instead of to call mom, or now you're using it for both. It's a very natural sort of extension from the history of the device.
And, you know, I know, you know, especially being over in HP Labs, that you guys just eat, breathe metrics and research and to inform where things are going, but to also inspire you to drive where that market might look like. Do you want to talk a little bit about that and how that relates to this audience that's looking to build business?
I'll tell you a little story about, we have this mobile app that we developed that was originally just an MMS service that you just take a picture of something and you get back information about it. And it was the simplest UI I could come up with, because every device would let you, you know, if you paid for the MMS service, you could just take a picture and send it off. And I thought, wow, that makes it so it can run on anything, because I didn't want to get involved with putting a app on a device because it was so hard at that time. And we went to a big box home improvement store that shall remain nameless and met with their CIO, because this application would allow you to take a picture of something. And then we have imaging technologies that will color correct the image and tell you exactly what that color is. So normally if you take a picture of something and you print it out or you look at it, the color values in it bear no resemblance to the actual object. And you can measure this with spectrophotometers and other colorimeters, and you can, like, no, those RGB values are not what that object is. So we had this technology that vastly improves the color calibration of an image, vastly improves it. So we took this demo to the CIO of the company, and this was about 3 years ago. And she said, oh, this is stupid. I don't want anybody measuring their wall paint or their carpet at home. I want them to gouge their wall out and bring a piece of drywall into my store. I don't want people doing mobile stuff at home. I want them in my store shopping. And that CIO is no longer there. And oddly enough, next month I have a meeting with that same company with a different CIO who says, you remember that mobile thing you talked to us about? Why, we think this is like the way to go. And I just see that that's the same company, it's the same group, they have the same product category, and all of a sudden now they're realizing that, you know what, maybe people like to shop from home. Maybe there's a value. And this woman who wants to get a wall color, not being able to go to the store 10 times to figure it out. Maybe if you took a picture of it and you understood what the color was and you got immediate recommendations that then she went to the store to buy or look at the final paint samples, there's value in that. So they're realizing that the mobile comments from the commerce that starts on the handset is so powerful because it's in situ shopping. It's where she's comfortable, it's where she's
at home or wherever she's trying to do her project. So that reach of the mobile is quite powerful. She doesn't have to go to a web browser. And especially reaching, we have these applications that work really well for home decor, which a lot of the specification of that comes from women. And what woman has all the time in the world to sit at a laptop browsing things for hours? I mean, women want to get something, measure it, get it done. So I think that that, it's the same company. And in 3.5 years, they're calling us saying, you know, we haven't seen anything like this, and they've tried some things that they just don't work as well. But that's the same company that before said you should gouge things out of your wall and bring it to the store, is willing to 180-degree turn. And what was funny was her staff, that was a little bit more forward-thinking, their jaws dropped when she said, because they patched drywall. They know how what a miserable experience this is. So I just see a tremendous difference. And also, I was at the National Retail Federation show in New York in January, and several people from Target were talking about how vastly their online shopping and mobile has grown. And they thought, oh, this is interesting before. And when I was at NRF 3 years ago, it was like, yeah, mobile's important. And they thought you just served up ads or maybe coupons. Now they realize people browse and buy when they're standing in the store, mm-hmm. before they get to the store, and now they have to consider it, and they look at it as an opportunity. So I see a vast difference in the mindset of the people who are really going to spend the money to develop some of these facilities.
It's also just what, building on what you were saying, when people, what you're saying, how, you know, it's really that, about people's time, and particularly for women, and they want to get it done. It's, what did someone say? It's not, people don't enjoy searching, they enjoy finding.
Yep.
And having a mobile device allows you, and particularly applications like that, to find quickly, because that's really what we care about. It was like when Google came out, I could just type in, and oh my God, it came up right away. I mean, and that was the value of it. And now we're seeing that, and that value even being more increased when you have it in a mobile setting.
It's interesting, too, to piggyback on that idea that in terms of retail and shopping, the experience, the trend has gone from I'm going into a store to I'm going to shop from home because I know that I can get more information and I can find better prices. Now, with mobile devices, it's come back full circle where I want to go to the store, I want to have the thing in my hands and play with it, but I'm also going to be on my phone, I'm going to be reading reviews, and I'm going to be doing a price comparison to see if it's even worth buying it while I'm here, or I should just enjoy this time that I get to spend with it and then go home and actually order it on Newegg or order it on Amazon.
Yeah, that brings up a great point, because a lot of the research we actually did at HP around consumer shopping and technology and the patterns that they do, but majority of consideration and evaluation stages start with friends, number one, mm-hmm. and number two, online. Through search. And what you find via search increasingly is powered by social and mobile activation, right? So whether somebody rates a product, posts about a product, tweets about a product, shares information about a product, you will all see that indexed on page one above the fold. So it's fascinating to me that, you know, but knowing that and taking that in the consideration cycle, right, people still want to go inside and touch and feel a product. They want to play with it. They want to know that it works. I mean, we were like three little girls up here playing with our new BlackBerry Playbook tablet. Sorry for the product mention. But it's not in stores yet, so everybody's been really fascinated about, oh, this is how it works. I've heard about it, et cetera, et cetera. But I'm like that when I'm trying, whether I'm trying new food or shoes or et cetera. I like to go in store and feel the product. And once I've done that, I may still go home and go through the consideration set. But mobile certainly makes it easier for me once I've made my decision or I'm in that consideration cycle to see it right then and there, scan the UPC, you know, scan the UC code, and be able to price compare immediately. I mean, heaven. So I know whether I'm going to save a buck or if I'm going to save 20 bucks. You know, I might drive somewhere, but for convenience sake, a buck won't make a difference to me. But it's nice to be able to have that immediacy. When we were talking on the phone the other day, we were talking about mobile features, and I wanted to ask you guys, what mobile features can you not live without, and how would that play into, you know, what maybe some of these ladies are thinking about when it comes to their businesses? Kind of a general question, I think. Let me put it in a business context. For your business and what you do professionally, what mobile features can you not live without?
For me, I get incensed if I'm reading a web page or reading something on the phone and I don't have a way to either send it to myself via email or share it with people on Facebook or Twitter. Give me a way to help you amplify that signal or give me a way to find that information. again. Another feature I can't live without is GPS, but that's going to depend on your business and what kind of functionality you need to provide.
I mean, I'd say it's funny, just the way, I guess the way that I, and I think the way most people get their news at this point, right? I mean, I don't know the last time. I mean, I still sometimes sit down and read the paper, but generally speaking, you know, that's the first place that I get all my information. And it's not, you know, from going to a site, you know, it's from having it delivered to me, whether it's the tech news or whether it's a different kind of news, and it's all aggregated and sent to me. And so I think there is still, you know, great value in applications. I've always, particularly in content, been a big believer that people still want a voice and a filter. If you can provide them those two things, then it has meaning and impact to people, and that definitely holds true on mobile.
I would say also personalization, particularly with content, too. There's a number of new players who, you know, if I have 1,000 news feeds in my feed reader, I need to know what's most important. So there are a number of apps out there that are trying to start to build a profile of me and what I like so that if I only have 10 minutes to look, the things that are most important to me personally are the things that rise to the top. And going sort of hand in hand with that is notifications. So if I really like what you're doing or if I need to have information in real time about a critical piece of technology, I want to be able to get a push notification or get a text message or ideally have it be sent in whatever method makes sense. Maybe it's something I need to monitor but not super closely, so I'd rather have it come via email. Or maybe it's something that's so important that I want to make sure it gets to me by SMS and Twitter and send me an email. The more options that I have to get that information back out again at the rate that makes sense for me, the better.
Makes sense. I want to use a question that I've heard a couple different times today, or I've heard it in the crowd. How do you go from idea to plausibility? So, especially in mobile, you have an idea for something that would either solve a problem or open up a market. But how do you go from idea to plausibility? How do you know what platform to start with? How do you measure the audience? How do you find developers to make it even possible on a mobile platform?
It definitely depends on who your customers are or who your audience is. So you should, you know, by nature, you should already know a lot of that information, what your demographics are. If you can sort of find out or intuit from those demographics what kind of devices they tend to use, great. If you can't, if you have a newsletter or a list of subscribers or sort of a close-knit community of folks that you could put a survey out to, ask them what devices they use, and even ask them what kind of value they would want in a mobile service. And you can even offer some incentives for them to participate. If you take part in our survey, win a chance to win a BlackBerry playbook, for example. And then you can get sort of an idea of where your customers already are and know better where to serve them. I don't think you have to be on every platform, but you want to aim to be where most of your customers are. Everyone knows time is limited, budgets are finite, so you can pick your battles there.
Anita, you bring a lot of things to market and a lot of things that don't. Can you maybe talk through that process and how it might help?
I guess the audience matters, but for me, I don't have that many questions about which platform, because basically if I want it to be a ubiquitous consumer experience, then guess what? You get to pick a lot of platforms, or you figure out how to do it with MMS in an early case, because then anybody can use it from any platform. It depends on what's important to prove at this stage. So I work with very deep technology. So for me, oftentimes it's a proof of a technical concept. Can you do it at all? And then what is a runtime on a mobile device? So porting it and having the runtime not be 10 minutes, but, you know, 2 seconds is a good thing. So proving that it can work on, you know, 17 servers racked and, you know, at 180 degrees is not a great proof for some of those things. And I work on technologies that deep. So if you have to prove market acceptance, that, you know, do you have to prove it's easy to use? Do you have to prove that someone will ever find this app and care about it? Do you have to prove that a retailer would pay for this app? Do you have to prove that this app converts to somebody from a browser to a buyer?
So ask yourself, what are the most important things that you have to prove? And everything else is a cardboard scaffolding. You have limited resources. So people will accept that you dummy up the stuff that's not pertinent. And you want to work with people who are creative enough to know that that's the part that you're not, it's not core. So if you have limited resources to buy, if you can have everything be done for real, great. But I've done plenty of demos to senior executives at HP where, okay, this is the part that's really hard, and this is what I'm going to show you running. You know, believe me about the slick this or that that could be on there. And they're like, yeah, that doesn't matter. We can get someone to do that. So decide what's your core value proposition. And if you're working with people who are not very creative, you might have to have more stuff that looks cool and works. But I've seen 101 sort of like dummied up flash websites, but there's nothing behind them. And I'm like, okay, great. I see you can write a title page. Yes, you can do a login screen. Very good. But did that really get you anything? So ask yourself, what is a core thing that you have to demonstrate that is the hurdle? And have that thing you're demonstrating be at your unique value proposition. If your unique value proposition is that you have a site that everybody wants to go to, like I really love the name mint.com. Mm-hmm. I thought, God, they're done when they came up with the name. I mean, you know, I mean, that's a great name. I just think that that is a huge thing. So if it's to make people aware of personal finance and where would you look and how would you search, that might be the core thing, that you've got the best strategy for getting the best names for that real estate on the web. That's brilliant. If your strategy is that you have a unique technical component, then you better prove it. If your technical component is because women who use this cannot stop, then you better be able to show, I allowed 12 people to use it and they won't stop. You know, it doesn't mean that it has to be 5,000. So I think it's perfectly acceptable to do focus groups with people that you meet at your child's daycare. I think that's okay. So figure out where you want to spend your money, but you can do focus groups, you can do things that are less expensive. And I've used focus groups that I've run with women that we've brought in for some of the technologies we built, and men too, and we were able to prove, you know, using like human-computer study kind of methodology, that this thing does result in this easier shopping experience or this easier experience, and you have to kind of collect that data, but decide yourself, what can you afford to do that will make a convincing case, right? You're just trying to convince somebody.
And I say, I guess it depends on who that case is, who you're convincing, right?
Yes.
I mean, if it's marketing people, flash demos work great,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
That's all you need.
That's
you
right.
know, if it's being able to convey that idea, then they don't need to see the back. They just need to see the beginning. But not in any disparaging way. No, but it's just when people see something in front of them, right, you can explain the idea and it sounds really great. Or when you mock up a PowerPoint, you know, there's only so much.
Yep.
But when someone can actually put it in their hand and walk through what the experience is like, because that's what people are engaging with, the experience, that's when a lot of times you can take that product to the next level.
Yeah, I think there are plenty of people right here in this valley, too, that can help you through those various stages, and increasingly online as well, to find experts who can advise you, whether it be through social networking, through their blogs, etc., that can help you through those various stages. But yeah, I wouldn't undersell the flash either. But to your point, you can't fake it when you're in this town.
It depends on what's cool
right.
about it.
If you're
in the content side,
yeah.
I think you would have
exactly.
to look good. You know, but the other thing I would say is I've heard executives say this to me, and I think it's true, is the higher up you go in the company, the less air there is in that meeting room. So you have to kind of get your message out quick and clean, and that's why sometimes a really cool demo, because they're not going to listen to you. You're not going to get to that third or fourth bullet point. You know, it's kind of like, well, let me look at that. And the best thing is if they can play with it themselves, it does work really well.
Well, I know we only have a certain amount of time, and we're going to open it up for. Do you guys have specific questions? Yeah, in the back of the room.
I'm Ann Ziegler with Viator Software, and I have a question about how do you navigate the considerations between all the different native platforms for app building versus. Publishing information that the user would access through the web page on the app. Because it seems like if you have limited resources, you can't necessarily build something for all the platforms. And there are also limitations with how you can distribute applications through the App Store, through these other mediums. They're not all available any old way. And I'm wondering, from your perspective with the high-end view of the industry and where it's going, if you have any guidelines or thoughts about how to I guess, how to just navigate that pathway through all the different native apps versus sort of web-based.
Yeah, I think Barb touched on it earlier, right? It's really knowing your audience and who your customers are and what platforms they use. Now, I don't work exclusively on mobile. I also still use the web. I still use print media. I think it depends on how they use it and what you're trying to do and what the application is, right? And meaning, what are you doing to help them reach their goals, their objectives to aspire, et cetera. So I think that will take you a long way, right? It's like the old marketing thing. Start with the objectives, ladder up the strategy to that, and then your tactics go ahead and support that. So you first have to understand your audience and who your customer base is. For us, when we look at stuff and what our customers want to do, I think it's really important that we embrace the tools that our customers and developers already use. So to develop for our playbook platform, for example, we have Flash built in. We have HTML 5.0 built in. We have other web tools that developers are already well-versed in, and so we want them to be able to use that skill set and to be able to quickly develop applications for our platform. But yesterday we also announced that you're going to be able to run certain versions of Android apps on our devices because, again, we know people are already well-versed in that and want to have a working ecosystem to do that and do the things that they want to do.
I would say the native experience is arguably the better experience, but I think depending on your budget and your timeline, you can get away with having less of a native experience. And I would use my company, Tekka, as an example of that, where we had a very aggressive timeline. We had to get a mobile app out. We knew we were going to launch a web platform immediately after. So the way that we handled it was to almost work backwards. We had the website, we knew what the functionality was going to be, and the first iteration of the mobile was primarily, especially in terms of the content, it was very much mimicking what you were seeing on the website with the addition of a couple of mobile-specific features like barcode scanning, for example. But now, a few months later, after the release, definitely our first priority is now to add in nativization. So I think you can get away with doing that after the fact. People do tend to notice it, and we have gotten some feedback in that regard, but you can get something out the door that's not a terrible experience and something that provides a lot of functionality that is similar to what you're offering on other platforms too.
In the iPhone platform, there is an ad hoc distribution method, so you can have a few copies of this, you know, if you know the device ID. You can do that and get, you know, you don't have to put it in the App Store is what I'm saying. So if you want to demo it to a few people, you can do the ad hoc license, which allows you to, if you give them the number, it'll you can put it on that. It's a hokier method for doing it, but you can do that. What I've tried to do is if you have some deep core technology behind it, I try to create a suite that is platform independent. So either, in my case, it might be C that can be embedded in an Objective-C program or that can be callable from Java for the Android platforms, and I try to keep a core base of this that doesn't have to get re-rolled every single time you do a platform. But the UI component of those apps are entirely different. The UI building experience is different, and the UI event handling is building is different. So I try to like skin them, and there's this old technology paradigm called model view controller. And so the view is always for the platform, because it has to be. And I try to keep everything else, the model, the core technology piece, as safely secured. And also the thing is, if you are successful, you're probably going to have to constantly be releasing this for all end platforms all the time. But I have had the case of one customer we're talking to, only all their professionals carried BlackBerries. So while one conversation was, I have to have this on an iPhone, the other conversation was, BlackBerry's all that counts for me. So, you know, it did depend a lot, and it was like night and day, right? You know, you're going from 100% BlackBerry to 100% iPhone conversation, and for the same back-end technology, so I feel like in that case, you know, if I had a core set of assets, and in the case of BlackBerry, I can deploy, they have a very unique architecture, I can deploy some of that C functioning code in a web interface that's callable by any mobile platform. So that's also a trick on the mobile, is how much is in the server side and how much is in the client side. In the first instance, you can have a dumber client
And with the 4G and 3G networks, it's not such a big deal. A dumber client querying your backend, which has all the assets in it, and not worrying about pushing everything onto the mobile. So that's an architectural choice that can be efficient.
I love it when Nina gets her geek on. Yeah. I'm just saying.
Sorry.
Yeah. Well, I'd even say from a business side, thinking about it, is there a platform that you can get marketing, right? Because it's like if the tree falls in the forest and no one can hear it. So, you know, almost reversing it and saying, is there a particular business? Is there a new platform launching? Is there something, you know, that you think you might actually be able to go in with what you have from that perspective and then focus your resources there, because that's what's going to come back to you, because they're going to focus resources on you.
Right. I mean, who would have thought of Flipboard, right? I mean, just someone just saw something beautiful, and it's just like there's a great way. Mm-hmm. You know, to cull and aggregate and collate data. It's really good. I think we had another question. Is that right?
Hi, my name is Danielle Wood. I'm from education.com. We're a content site for parents. My question is, you're all from, most of you are from pretty big companies where you have a lot of engineering resources. But for those of us that are from smaller companies of maybe, you know, six engineers, something like that, do you feel we're at a point in time where one of your engineers should be a mobile expert, or for a small company like that, you should still be outsourcing that sort of work?
I think it depends on your product, right? It's a great question, but I think it depends on what you do and what your service is. But I think increasingly, especially with consumer and small and micro business interactions, that, yeah, it has to be a consideration. I think one way to get around that, if you don't have the capital or the resources in order to grow that team or focus someone's energy on it, is to look at like a revenue share model, right? If you need someone to develop with you and build some kind of extension for you, then if there's a revenue model toward it, then maybe you can share that revenue with some developers. Even big companies do that, right? I mean, you look at what Netflix did with their business, and I used to work there and help launch Netflix years ago, and it was always going to be about the streaming. Where do we get that extra algorithmic, right, crunching number type thing to make better movie recommendations? As incredible as their talent is in-house, they open-sourced it and said, here's $1 million prize, take us another percentage point or two to do it. And I think the guys that ended up winning probably actually donated some of the money or donated to their schools and universities as more of a bragging project, right? But you can get out there and get help. Barb is probably more well-versed in this than I am when it comes to finding those developers and the terms under which they'll work with you. But you can look beyond just dedicated in-house resources. I don't think any of us can scale fast enough. Yeah, for this or social, but you guys might have different.
I mean, I can actually do you one better. We're smaller. We only have 2 developers. So to get our mobile app out, we outsourced it. We had a very aggressive timeline, and it just made more sense. There's definitely advantages and disadvantages to both. I mean, when you outsource, you have to think about location. If they're in a different time zone and you can't talk to them after 2 p.m., you know, that might be a problem. They're not as invested or tied to your product. They're getting a spec sheet and, you know, building something to taste, whereas you might have shifted gears for even a day and thought of going in a different direction, and you're already out of sync, whereas if you're in-house, you're all together sort of in the same boat. But it's also a little bit, it can be more expensive to go that route. So we are in the process now of bringing more of that development in-house, where you get more of the benefits of stakeholders who actually have a interest in seeing that product succeed beyond this is our contract for X number of months and then it's done.
There are a lot of contractors who just specify, you know, that they just work on mobile platforms, and if you can get somebody who's specifically on a mobile, it's just fast. It's compared, you know, or you can bring somebody in and have them do it, but it's tough, and I just want to let you know that in the big companies, you struggle for resources. You will have power. The lights will stay on. Your paycheck will probably come and be casual. But there is a huge thing, and I start projects inside of HP Labs, which I hope will lead to new businesses for HP. But HP likes businesses in the big B-sounding words and not in the M-sounding words. So they're always willing to squash you, right? So it's kind of like, why should I put any money on you? And literally, we have to pitch to make that. So sometimes you think that other people have it because we have the liability of being in a big company. So the processes we have to do to actually get anything done are just, I wouldn't even go into stories like that. They're just ridiculous. So there's a tax on your time, right? So you actually have less time, whereas, you know, your focus. And if you brought somebody in to add to your six people one, and that's all they did, they'd get so much done. So I wouldn't look at the big companies. In fact, big companies go and acquire little companies. Why? Because they're agile. They get stuff done, and there's none of this overhead. And then they bring them in and put overhead on them. And then they wonder what happens. but I do think that the mobile is a specialized area. And if you can find somebody who's really good at multi-platform, it's a great investment in-house. Because even using the UI builder, I would at least have somebody in your team who can do the UI dummy up, just so you can see it quickly, because it's easier to specify than a spec sheet overseas. So you need to have some of that. But there are great people who will go and, you know, kind of an app a day, you know, they're really good at it.
Well, particularly for what you're doing, right? I mean, for education, for kids' stuff. I mean, you know, that is moving faster in mobile and tablet than anything else. So if you look at, you know, where the business is going, right, and particularly your business, it would seem to make more sense to put some of those resources there because you know it's only going up.
Yeah, I mean, I look at the market for that, right? I mean, I was talking with some girlfriends that I saw here earlier today, and they were just so excited. By one hand, they can just pass it back in the car, right? You know, okay, you know, do whatever you want and play with it, but do it in an educational way. I was talking with Beth Fleckerman just, you know, a month ago, and I said, you know, what are the apps you want to see the most? And she said, for my kids, you know, for fun, for learning, for everything. And I think that represents a huge market that likely doesn't get as much coverage from the technology sector and the technology media as it should. And we can change that in this room. I mean, one of the reasons that I'm here, that I used to come to this conference on behalf of HP, is believing in this market, believing in women, believing in multicultural in ways that traditional marketing or media do not. So look at that market. I think it's huge. I mean, we're more than half the population. It just kind of makes sense to me. I think there's another question in the back of the room. Yeah?
Yes, you guys talked a little bit about using mobile and multi-channel shopping in store. Can you talk a little bit about mobile payments on the horizon? There's skepticism whether it's really going to take off or not, and I'd love you guys to chat about the mobile payment system a little bit.
Is it taking off here, or is it already taken off globally? It's kind of a mixed question, because it certainly has taken off globally.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a financial system globally. So here I think it will. I think it's just a standards thing with NFC and who adopts it, but I'll defer to you on that one.
I think the most operational system right now is something like Square, where you can literally get a dongle that attaches to your iPhone or iPad and be able to take credit card payments right there. And that's, I think, poised to really revolutionize a lot of smaller businesses, people that otherwise wouldn't have a way to do a point of sale easily. And then things like NFC, it's a lot more nascent. There's a lot of experimentation going on. There are a number of big players looking at it, Google, Best Buy, Apple. There's lots of rumors about the next iPhone being NFC-enabled. Now that those big players are sort of sniffing around that technology, I think we'll start to see a much bigger push into it. But I do think it is a little bit further out, maybe another year or two before it becomes more predominant.
But also if there's a market for it, right, if people are developing in a certain area, I mean, I'm just speaking historically as a journalist, not officially on behalf of BlackBerry, but when you see a certain movement or trend, tipping point, sometimes one model is adopted more so than the other. You can go all the way back to Betamax and VHS, right? I mean, you just see where the content goes and where the adoption and traction is. But, you know, this is right
so
up your alley.
NFC, you know, when I went to Japan and Korea in 2002, 2003 for a bunch of meetings with big carriers out there, it was just taken as granted. I mean, they're not – so it's not nascent to me as a technology because it's been done. I mean, you know, Docomo was doing this quite a long time ago, and every child can pay for anything on a street corner with their cell phone in Japan. It's not a question of technology. It's really a question of comfort and expectation. And, you know, people were really scared. I remember doing some HCI studies on web, and we were working on web performance, and what people started to feel like if a website was really slow, they thought it was going to be insecure.
Mm-hmm.
Like they didn't want to put their credit card number if the website was slow. Like, oh, it's gonna lose it or something. And I was like, I'm working on performance of web. What's it got to do with security? Nothing in my mind, but in the consumer's mind, there is. So I would say that this is one of the reasons people wanted to make their sites faster is just because people wouldn't give their credit card number. They impugn the entire integrity of the site because of performance. So I think that a lot of it's consumer adoption, but I have to say when I see what people are willing to pay for really quickly with the iTunes store on their handset from an iPhone perspective. I mean, you're already paying things, you know, as soon as you type in your passwords, it's debiting your credit card right, left, and center, especially if your 9-year-old gets a hold of your phone. So, you know, that's happening. And so people are comfortable with that. So to me, I look at that as a big crack in the whole system. And I think you're absolutely right. I think it will come, and I think it's just consumer acceptance of it. But, you know, who hasn't gotten an email that says, "We're sorry, but a laptop was stolen and your social security number was on it"? So I think we're all getting kind of a little security fatigue, mm-hmm. in a way, and we kind of want the convenience of it. And I had this experience in 1997. I was sitting on the French Riviera at a conference having dinner, and this waiter walks out on the French Riviera on the beach having dinner, and he has this mobile payment system. Right, he just swipes my credit card. So we're at the beach, right? He's not gonna walk back and forth so he's just like doing this. And this is in France in 1997.
That is so weird. That was my first experience with it too, was in France in 98.
And I just looked at this and I was like, what gives with us, right? Yeah. And I was there for a networking conference. I'm like, look at this guy. He just walked out here and he did that. And we're going back to our modern technology in California. And the waiter can do what we couldn't do in California, wirelessly and everything.
There's a lot to learn from global. Right? I mean, you look at what happens in Asia and the rate of development there, their bandwidth there, right? What's being developed in Europe, even as pilot test cases, or even in so-called third world, right? You know, in developing economies, emerging economies. The innovation there is just incredible, just out of necessity, mm-hmm. you know? And what we, you know, adopt as our own, it's very different from what you see globally. Does that help answer your question? Yeah? We have another one?
Piggybacks off of the comments that were made about children and educational content for the new tablet devices. Are there any other areas that larger companies might be ignoring or underserving where you think there may be an opportunity for smaller outfits, people who are more agile?
I think especially with the rise of 4G networks now in this country, we're going to see a number of industries changing and disintermediating that people might not normally associate with mobile. Things like transportation, education for sure, healthcare, energy management, so like smart grid and smart home applications. I think those are the sectors that are going to be those huge, you know, businesses with a B and not as much with an M, where even a small player can get in on the ground floor and be, you know, have those learning experiences and be in an industry early as it starts to take off.
Yeah, I mean, this is right up your alley.
Yeah, I mean, I would say, you know, it's interesting. I was just looking at some stuff that looked at how tablet users compare to just average media consumption. And, I mean, across the board, whether radio, television, I mean, the tablet consumers consume at a higher rate and more hours than regular customers do. And some, you know, it's a little bit higher for radio and, you know, a few hours higher for television. It's twice as much, or 2.5 times for movies. It's 3 times for games. It's almost 2 times for publications, for magazines, and things like that. So I think there's actually a lot of opportunity, you know, across all of those areas, because particularly from the tablet side, you're just getting much larger consumers of media overall. And then it becomes just the issue of, okay, well, where's the niche, right? Where's the place that's really being underserved or not served in a way that you think the consumers are going to want it? But I think there is room in a whole lot of different areas when you look at that market, because they really highly over-index in all of the consumption.
I think there's always vertical markets that are specific to community groups that big companies kind of don't have the expertise in, so they try to do horizontal technologies, and anything that's very specific to community, they don't realize. One thing that surprised me about technology pickup is I don't think anybody intended the tablet-sized devices to be really great for older people, mm-hmm. but I think they actually are, and a lot more people are comfortable getting on the web and using them once because they're intuitive, they're easier. Older people can't deal with the mouse. They can't move it around. And the small buttons on the mobile, I mean, there's lines of cell phones that were sold just because they had the really huge buttons, right? And, you know, arthritic hands and poor eyesight, you know, it's really hard. So I think there's devices that are now reaching communities that before probably weren't going to be really excited about having a mobile device. So I think that that mobile web line is really blurring because of these different form factors of devices. But I think there's people who, I think in a lot of large companies, the canonical user is sort of a 17-year-old boy, you know, kind of thing. I think that's what they think of as being, what does a 17-year-old boy want? But there's a lot of the world that's not a 17-year-old boy, a lot. And I think that now we're seeing devices that are appealing to much, much broader groups of people that I think are going to drive content and they're going to drive experiences in a way that a gaming 17-year-old was kind of the canonical buyer that I think that a lot of male executives had in their mind was somebody like their son.
And now you look at Zynga, where their average gamer is a 43-year-old woman. I mean, you know, right? Totally different market.
Yeah. Well, just one factoid, fastest growing segments, so 13 to 17-year-olds, 86% increase in mobile, and 55-plus, 78% increase. So you think about the aging population, if you're just talking nationally here, in this country. I mean, it makes a lot of sense, right?
Yep. Hey, Beth Blackman, Tech Mama. Yes, mobile is definitely the hot area. It seems like the hottest area is a lot of entrepreneurs are looking into that. But I'm wondering, like you were talking about that your first experience, you know, mobile payments in France, and I was thinking about infrastructure. Like, is our infrastructure really ready for all this mobile devices? And if you're an entrepreneur, you know, where do you put your egg in the basket? Because I was thinking, even my own house, I have only 24 megabits per second. Yeah. And if you think about all the millions of devices, I'm running into a wall already. Mm-hmm. So if you think...
Mobile payments are not a bandwidth issue.
No,
but you just mean generally infrastructure-wise. Just general infrastructure-wise.
Yeah.
I mean, say, you know, one of the clients that I work with is Alcatel-Lucent, and they put in the ground, you know, pipe, I mean, and all of the networking equipment for 4G. And so, you know, it's tough. Not all of the things that we do, I mean, there's a lot of studies that say if we tried to consume content in the way that broadcast does, the systems just break, you know. It doesn't really work that way. But we're not there yet. And the rise of certain technologies like 4G and the proliferation that has happened, and Verizon just launched, you know, all their cities and continuing to grow, I think is an area that for maybe not for all of the high bandwidth, if everybody's on and doing the same thing, then you're going to have a problem. But at least for the near-term future, I think with the things like 4G, you're going to that infrastructure will probably cover a lot of the applications and things we're looking at.
I think you'll continue to see improvements as well in the hardware and in the bandwidth and the algorithmic things that crunch it and make it easier to use, because you think about the computing devices of where we are today and what you were able to do here took a tower, right, just even 8 years ago.
And it's the smart network, too. I mean, that's the other part of it, because bandwidth is one aspect to it, but what the network can actually do and being able to route traffic preferentially to know, you know, whether they can know location-based services, like, you know, am I going to serve the same thing if I know somebody is sitting at home on their laptop or they're on their wireless device standing in front of a movie theater. So there's a lot of that, you know, it's not just about necessarily more throughput, but about smart technologies back in the network that a lot of companies are starting to use.
The other thing about bandwidth is you've got to be careful. Sometimes you're using your 4G device, right? I've always been impressed at what radio engineers are able to do to go back and get more bandwidth, but there is something called Shannon's Law. There's only so much encoding you can do and so much bandwidth that you can do. And so there can be improvements on it, but I think that now we have infrastructure that are hotspots. So when we think wireless, right, it's not that the back, it's not just that the big wireless carriers are going to have, you know, the coverage that way. It's not all a cell phone infrastructure. There's other hotspots, and a lot of people will use in a coffee shop. They'll use that in those kinds of locales. But I was trying to do demos at big conferences, and I can't get a signal to save my life. You know, you just can't do it. So in that case, in those, and there's been a lot of research in this area of mobile computing in terms of network bandwidth. I mean, like, you know, 15 years ago about how to marry the hotspot with the high density and pico networks to you know, give. So it's basically, you know, how much signal strength and how much can you pack it in. And there's great equations that cover this. You know, so cows come home. I mean, there's lots of papers on this. But the point is, I think that there's other things we can do in our infrastructure. So when you're sitting at home using your mobile device, you will have a seamless experience. The fact that you're getting it from your home Wi-Fi network versus a 4G. You switch over, you don't even think about it, right? You don't think about it anymore. You did, if 10 years ago, you would have thought about it in a big way. But you don't think about it now. And so I think that those, you're going to see a hybrid model, and you're not going to care that you're bouncing from one network to the other. You know, that's going to be, that's going to solve a lot of those problems, because not everything can be carried by the 4G networks if we're all in this conference. So, like, the conference problem would be solved if they just put in a few Wi-Fi right. spots with cables carrying network, you know, T3s into there, you'd be done. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I just think that that will happen more. But for very large-scale areas, you know, only the freeways are covered. I mean, think about rural folks, right? Just the freeways, the interstates have the cell phone coverage, and then it's, you know, we used to do these trips where we'd say, oh, do we get anything? Like, parts of northern Arizona, like, we're really out there. There's nothing on this thing. There's no bars, you know. And there are places like that. But you know, wired, in that case, wired or satellite works. But I think that it's evolving, and I don't think that's going to be our first problem.
Yeah.
And I'm interested in developing a mobile app too, but part of it is, you know, I can't help but think that there's a negative social consequence to how rapidly we're ramping this up because we can, not necessarily because it may be right, we're ramping up because we might have a lot of money, but on the one hand, it may make some things easier. On the other hand, I do worry about the impact all this stuff is going to have on people.
I think it's a fair question. I'm no anthropologist, but, you know, it's something that I've just observed over time, having covered it as a journalist and then jumping to the dark side and doing marketing and looking at what technology does for people. I still think we're in a very positive stage just because of the potential. And the possibilities it opens up for us as a culture, for us as women, for families, and what it can do to advance a society. I do, you know, being fair, I do look at my niece and nephews, you know, in that age, you know, walking around literally bumping into things. They'll text each other from the other room. You know, it's interesting, but to them that's normal. So I think it depends on your generation, what's native to you. What's native to your culture? I think it all depends.
I think there's a fear that kind of develops around almost any new technological adoption. You know, things that happened when the telegraph was invented. Oh, it's going to break down the fabric of society. When movies were invented. Oh, it's going to kill radio. It's going to kill, you know, people aren't going to talk to each other anymore because they're going to just sit in a room and watch, you know, pictures go by. I think that it's a bit of a double-edged sword because you are being handed all these great new ways to stay connected and be connected and maintain connections. And I look at things like all the people from high school that I am in contact with on Facebook who I otherwise might never have talked to again. I think about how easy it is to, you know, drop my sister a text really quickly when I'm, you know, in the middle of doing something else. And I try to look at where those benefits are versus when I start to feel burnt out, because that's sort of the other end of the spectrum. And I think there is a lot of shifting cultural practice, both in social life and in a work context too, where people are feeling a lot more pressure to be online at all times or to be checking their email or to be available to answer this question when they're on their vacation type of thing. But that's ultimately up to us. It's still up to us if we need to turn off that device, we need to take that internet vacation, we need to find that balance for ourselves. I think it's going to be a process, and for a lot of people it'll be messier, ups and downs than others, but ultimately it is up to us. These are the tools that are supposed to be helping us to be more fulfilled in our lives. It's up to us to sort of find that balance of where they are providing utility versus where they're burning us out.
Okay. I have one comment on the shopping in a store and talking to somebody next to you. The person who was too shy to talk to somebody next to them now has a mobile app that they can check because they would be too, like, uncomfortable. Or maybe the person says, do you know if this is any good? I just see a review here. And then they engage that way. So I think a lot of it comes down to actually how we're socializing as a society to be brought up. The one thing I have more of a concern about, and this is like my pseudo-anthropology hat on, is that we don't keep correspondence. We don't, like, I have letters when I moved from, like, a girlfriend of mine when I lived in Oregon, and I moved to Arizona. She lived in Oregon. We wrote letters every week, and we kept in contact. And when I look at them, I was like, I'd forgotten about that going on. Oh, look what she said here. Oh, we were talking about this. I'd forgotten all this stuff. And I just feel like, gosh, what do I have now for the last 10 years? Like, I don't have any hardly, I would say, analog, stable forms of storage of correspondence. You know, I don't have that. So I sort of wonder, like, over the long haul, what do we do with them? I don't have a record of anything I've said, and maybe you save your tweets.
No, well, you know, it's interesting because I have two little girls, and so we have set up emails for them. Someone gave me the advice. So because I haven't gotten around to put the baby books together, but I can, when something happens or a picture or whatever, just type an email to them. So now, actually, I'm using it as a permanent record and as a sort of a baby book, you know, as they grow up, and having the grandparents do the same thing. So it may not be in the physical form, but really cool. At least 10 years I can print them all off and, you know, and go from there. Yeah, I know. I thought so, too. I'm like, that's fantastic. I can do
this. This combines several things from the green curves and Arizona not having any connectivity. But also the analog and the hard copy kind of dilemma. And I am an anthropologist.
Great. You should take the point. You should be up here.
But one of the things that, and being like where we are geographically right now, people forget that there's this whole section of the country that has had information very controlled in its access to it. And they're just really come online. I mean, yes, they've been on lists and things like that, but it's so far back. The first town I ever found that was completely wired, free Wi-Fi everywhere, was a Mennonite community. And are we missing these huge rural markets? That could have big, significant political change being done in voter plots and such by not developing mobile apps for farmers. Mm-hmm. You know, not everybody lives here in technology. So just if you could kind of spin off on some of that. I'm trying to put it all together.
I think it's...
is Casita Gaia, you know, because we all take care of the house. And the house is the whole world.
I think it's really interesting because where my company is headquartered is in Waterloo, Ontario, Canada, and a very large Mennonite community 5 minutes from my headquarters building. And actually there are some developers that live in those communities. I think it's fascinating when we look at the rural applications. I want to pass it over because I think we're running out of time here. But
I was just going to say that that Obama just passed the mobile broadband initiative, which I think is going to start to push further into serving some of those communities and kind of go that last mile and bridge that digital divide that has existed for a while. Of course, that's going to take a little bit of time. But even just to speak to the point about developing apps for farmers, not that long ago I read a story, I think it was in The Atlantic, about farmers using Twitter to coordinate around the best ways to organize their crops or, you know, what kind of weather was coming or what prices they were getting. So there are ways that those communities are being served. I think you're right that it's definitely underserved. And to speak to your earlier question, there again, there's another opportunity for people to come in and serve a market that has been traditionally underserved.
It takes a lot of listening, you know, and that's probably the biggest opportunity is that we all talk a lot, but we have two of these, and you can identify a lot just by listening.
You could also look at some of the early work that Nokia did because they worked with Sonera, which is the telecom provider in Finland, and reindeer herding is done by cell phone. Right. So they were giving very rural, and they just decided that they were, as a country, going to make it ubiquitous. So they were very rural people living above the Arctic Circle with... So you know, yeah, because I was going to say they're rural people who had access. Yes.
Well, it's time to go. I think the other panel's getting ready to start and move in. Thank you so much for being with us and for your questions. And thank you to the fellow panelists as well.
Thanks.
Thanks, you guys.
Thanks.
It was
great.
Yeah, it was fun.
This is a good discussion.
Hi.
Thank you for having me on your author, all of you.
Got a little.